Hallo und herzlich willkommen. Heute hier mit mir, dem Alex und Raphael vom Game Brewer, werden wir über die Neuerscheinung im Jahr 2021 sprechen. Ich bin schon sehr gespannt und für euch zur Information, ich werde jetzt gleich ins Englische umswitchen, denn der Raphael, der versteht einiges an Deutsch, aber es ist
Ja.
dann doch besser, dass wir das Ganze in Englisch halten. Also an der Stelle wünsche ich uns beiden, Raphael und mir, jetzt schon mal viel Spaß und wir gehen jetzt erstmal durch das Programm, ja, von den Game Brewer Neuheiten. So, hello Raphael, nice that
Hi.
you are here with me in this little, chat call interview. I don't know.
Exactly, my pleasure. How are you doing?
Right now, very, very good. So I think the last time we met in person was last year in Nuremberg. So I'm really
Yeah,
excited that I
exactly.
can hear your lovely voice and talk about some more lovely games. And let's jump into a first title. This is a title that the German version will come out from another publisher, Austria
Correct. Yeah,
Spiele.
Austria Spiele, yeah.
And this is Arkwright, the card game, is
Exactly.
really successful Kickstarter in December 2020. Can you tell me a little bit what's so special about the card game version?
Yes. So the card game, I mean, it sometimes give a bit, maybe a bit of a wrong impression because people think it's just a card game. It's still very much a board game with a board and player boards. But for the people that maybe not know Arkwright, obviously the card game was based on the actual board game. And the designer, Stefan Risthaus, was the one that decided I want to make a bit of a more streamlined version of this game. Because the original is also absolutely amazing, but it's a very long and it's a very heavy game. And so he tried to simplify quite a few things and streamline the process of opening factories and producing your goods and everything. And he came up with this really clever idea where most of the cards have actually two halves, and you actually rotate or flip the cards according to what you're doing in the game. And it's still, I mean, it's a deceptively rich and all-encompassing game because it's a small box, but there's a lot of game in the box for sure. And yeah, we're very excited to have that launch. That will be the first launch of Game Brewer
Really
this
cool.
year.
So you shortened the amount of playing time, but not the
Yep.
fun. And also maybe important in these times, there's also a solo mode included. Can you tell me a little bit more about this
Yes.
mode?
Yeah, so the solo mode is basically focusing you on trying to get a score as high as you possibly can, but you still have to also beat two opponents that you have. So usually in a lot of solo modes, you actually have to tackle just one Ultima player. That is kind of a common thing. But here you have two actually, and they both actually start with more shares and a higher value than you do. And you have to try and keep up with them all the while trying to not only beat them, but also trying to get a certain high score and achieve certain things as well. Because one of the nice things that Stefan also designed for the solo mode is there's a lot of different achievements and a lot of different things that you can try to really spice it up every time you play it. So it's quite challenging, I have to say. The first time I played it, I did get my ass whooped, but it's fun though. It's really nice to actually have a really challenging, solo mode. I think it's and it plays really smoothly actually. The nice thing is there's no extra components really needed aside from a little bag, and that's it. So it's nice to actually use all the components that the game has to offer in
Yeah,
there.
so it's sounds really great. I think if it's too easy to beat the AI,
Yeah.
it's nothing meet there. So if you are looking for industrial revolutionary board game in the 18th century and don't want these big board game, I think the card game version, Arkwright the card game, is right the thing for you. So let us go to the next thing, Rule Benders. And I
Yes.
saw the cover graphic on Board Game
Yeah.
Geek, and I like this style. I think it's a little bit like Fallout. I don't know, is this
Yeah.
intended? So yeah.
It
And
actually wasn't, but there's a funny story behind that because originally the box was going to look a lot more ancient. The story was a bit of a something that was found that was a lot more ancient. But Najade, who's the really quite famous illustrator of the game, he came up with the idea of making it more something around the periods of the 50s because especially in Belgium, we associate that with like the World Expo and a time of a lot of like technological advancement. And we really liked having that retro feel actually to the game, and it fit so well that we decided to keep it, and it actually even changed the gameplay a little bit along the way, because we came up with other elements that weren't there in the first place. So it was a very exciting game to develop, actually.
And I've read the bullet point time traveling, and I think the title of the game is the game, because rule benders and you are twisting the rules in the game. How is this mechanic works?
Yeah, so it's not as much time travel as we almost want to say, it's theme traveling. Because in the game, so first of all, one of the big things that you have to do every game is that you have 6 themes in the base game, but you choose 4 of them, and every theme, so every deck of cards, has a very specific effect, let's say. So for instance, the pirates, if you play with the pirate deck, it's going to be a lot more aggressive than, say, the fantasy deck. And so you kind of have to choose at the beginning already, like, what kind of game are we going to play? What's the general atmosphere going to be like? Essentially, the rule benders is an area control and majority game. So you are trying to actually get a majority on 7 different rule panels, and those panels change the rules of the game. Some have a deeper effect than others. Some, for instance, will just decide on, like, the limit, for instance, of your hand, or others will define how many energy cubes everybody gets at the beginning of the round. But others are more impactful. For instance, there's one that will actually define the currency of the game, because there's 3 different types of currency, but there's always one official one, let's say, that you have to use. So as the game progresses, people try to obviously bend those rules to their advantage, seeing, you know, how everybody else is doing and what they think is advantages to them and maybe disadvantages to the other players.
Yeah, so in this game, 2 to 5 players, you can bend the rules, like it's called even in the title. And let us go to your next title. So I think we are going a little bit more in the historic theme again, 17th century in Russia.
Yes.
Stroganov, or I don't know how you pronounce it in Russian.
I mean, my Russian is not the best. I just say Stroganov, but I think a lot of people think of the beef Stroganov when they hear it. But the recipe was actually named after the family that we talk about in this game. So Stroganov is actually another collaboration that we had with Andreas Steding. So we made Gugong together a couple of years ago. And now we're back with actually a new collaboration. And this is a game that really challenged us again, that was right up our alley, because it's there's a lot of strategy. It's a very meaty game. It's more complex, I want to say, than Gugong, for sure, because there's a lot going on in this game. But the main mechanic of the game is actually quite simple. You only have 1 meeple, 1 Cossack, that you're going to basically send through Siberia. And you start in the west of the region and travel all the way east. And the more you progress, you try and actually collect furs that you want to bring back, and you want to discover more things and then bring back certain things to the Tsar, because in the end you want to, like, do proud to the family of your family name of Stroganov, because everybody plays a member of the family, and you try to bring back as much, you know, great stories and glory that you can.
And I think these glorious things also represented by the product, by the artwork, a beautiful landscape on tiles that you can put down. I saw only a few pictures, and it is really eye-catcher, I think, when it's presented on the table.
Yeah, it's a spectacular looking game, I think. We actually, because I discovered an artist called Maciek Janik, who's from Luxembourg, and Maciek has a very painterly style. And so from the beginning, I thought that it would be really fitting, because I wanted something, at the same time, something very elegant, but I wanted something not to be too cozy, because we're talking Siberia and harsh environments and all that. But I wanted it to also be colorful. So it was quite the challenge, but I think Maciek did an incredible job. I mean, the cover has already received, like, incredible responses from everyone.
Yeah, it's like a painting, like an artwork thing. Yeah. So you can put it on the wall and say, hey, it's a classic Russian painting.
Exactly. The funny thing is, because we are actually launching the Kickstarter for that game in February, and one of the things we're thinking about is actually offering the artwork as artwork as well, where you will literally be able to hang that on the wall. Because we think it's a very painterly game. But it's honestly been an amazing project as well. well to work on. It's such a fun and challenging game, and offers a lot of replayability as well, because there's so many elements and there's so many ways to play and win the game. And that's something, yeah, that I think Andreas has come up with another fantastic design.
And also the player count 1 to 4 player, yeah. You also can enjoy it solo. And another game is also 1 to 4 players, and from the correct designer from Troyes or Black Angel is in German Hippocrates, Hippocrates.
Yeah, it's there's many. It's always a question. The funny is because we have some American colleagues, and they also sometimes pronounce it different ways.
Yeah, what the
I
right
just tend
way
to say Hippocrates, but I think we all know who we're talking about.
Yeah. Some, you know, these stuff with the snakes around it as a cover also look really amazing. And yeah, we are going back again in history, ancient Greece. Oh, yeah. I think something 370
BC. Yeah, exactly. So we go way, way back this time. And so Alain, who's actually fun, he's also Belgian, because we're a Belgian company. So it was fun to work with somebody that was a bit more local this time. But Alain is an incredible designer. I mean, he's worked on some fantastic games, and so we were very, very intrigued when he proposed us the prototype. And it's an incredibly clever puzzle type of game, I want to say. It's not like a physical puzzle, but more of a mental puzzle. Because the idea is that he was inspired when he traveled to the island of Kos in Greece. And because that's where the Temple of Asclepios is located. And that was, in a way, kind of the first hospital, I want to say, in the world. So people would travel from all over the Mediterranean to that temple to try and get treatments. And that's exactly what you do. So you step in the footsteps of Hippocrates, who's actually just perished in the game. And so you follow him up in a way. And yeah, so patients come in to the temple and you basically try to find the right doctors and associate the right doctors with the right patients and try to score victory points that way, and notoriety as well, because there's two types of scoring in the game, which is quite cool as well. And so there is a bit of a bidding and auction to it, because you basically are going to try and lure specific patients that you want to, and every patient will give you certain advantages, and you have to choose obviously according to your strategy what you think is the most important, because you have to juggle a lot of things in the game. And some patients, for instance, will be easy to cure and you'll be able to actually, you know, save them quite quickly, but then they won't give you as many victory points as others. But there is a bit of a time is of the essence, obviously, because if certain patients that need a lot of care are not treated on time, they may actually die. So you really want to try and get make sure that everybody gets the right treatment. And so there's auction, there's a little bit of bidding, there's some puzzling instead, because the pieces all physically like kind of click into each other, and you try to make your schedule like that. So we will actually be sharing artwork very soon of the game. I can already tell it's going to be quite spectacular, this one as well. And we're very excited.
I think the theme is quite unique, playing in physical in the old Greece theme thing is really, really nice. So I'm really looking forward to see more pictures about the game and see it hit the table. And for now, there is one more thing that you are going to present us this year. And this is an expansion, a small one, a big one. I really don't know. Tell me more.
It's a fairly small one, but that has some serious consequences. So Paris is getting an expansion, and it will be called L'Étoile, based on the famous roundabout where the Arc de Triomphe is sitting in Paris. And so the game adds even more bonus tiles than before, and you're actually going to randomize and customize your bonus tiles for that game. And so the new bonus tiles offer new effects, some different things that we haven't seen before. But on top of it all, it really changes the function of the arc, because for people who have maybe played the game, when you place one of your keys on the arc in the base game, the advantage is that you can actually go and occupy any of the districts as before, but it doesn't give you any money. So it's always kind of like, where I go there, do I not go there? Because I get more flexibility, but you know, I'm not going to get an income if I do so. However, this time there's a special power tile. So there's these special abilities almost, and everybody starts with one at the beginning of the game. But then if you do place one of your keys on the arc, you can actually swap your tile with another of the 7 which are available. And so each player gets a special power. So the game suddenly becomes asymmetrical, because in the beginning of, you know, in the base game, everybody starts at the same level, but here everybody has actually special powers. So in terms of physical, it won't be a big box. It will just be a pretty small box with just two punch boards in there. But it really does change the game. And it was very cool because the authors, Wolfgang Kramer and Michael Kiesling, actually already kind of had that idea when we were working on the game. And we thought it was really interesting. They already thought of that, but yeah, they developed it. And so that will be also something coming out later this year.
Ah, okay. So yeah, like you said, small expansion, but big impact at the game. So
yes.
Yeah, sounds, and if you love Paris, why not have this expansion and even more fun? That brings us to, I think, a little bit different topic because you created, I think, a new brand. This brand Insight or a new company?
Yeah, it's a new brand. So it's actually also, Amusa Games is basically focusing more on family oriented games, so the lighter games, because we already had a game, like a couple of games like Architectura and Festo in our range, but they're quite different from most of the other games that we've published, and we decided to have maybe more of a clear communication, whereas Game Brew is always going to focus on the more strategic, like medium heavy Euro games to maybe even heavy, whereas Amusa Games is very much fun for the whole family, but we still want to make it a challenge for both kids and adults alike. We still want people to not think, oh, these are just kids games. So and it was inspired just because we were getting so many prototypes as well in from those types of games, and we thought, well, there's some really, really cool concepts in there. So that's how Amusa was born.
Oh, yeah.
And we're going to launch three games actually this year.
Yeah, and for all Amusa, it's also fun related because this is in Esperanto is the word for fun. So fun is the highest value that games, I think, can have in this brand. Let's start with maybe the first title, and from Festo, the seam eating something so there's pizza,
exactly,
the two to four player game, and do you have a game board there are slices of pizza, and what do you want, eat the pizza or get something on the pizza?
You actually make the pizza. So the idea is that, you have a number of customers that come to restaurants, and everybody basically is one of the chefs and pizzaiolo. So you're basically trying to make the pizza, and you try to serve specific customers. But every customer has specific demands. Some are like, I only want, a vegetarian one, or I want one with a ton of meat, and I want some, with pineapple on it, yes or no. So we decided, the idea was really great. The funny thing is it was born actually in the beginning as a print and play, but we thought it would be more fun to create it this way. So everybody's got a pretty big pizza in front of them, but it's completely empty. So we've got like a very basic cheese base.
Margarita style.
Yeah, you kind of have a margarita to start with. And so what you're going to do is at the beginning of a turn, four dice are rolled, and those dice are going to basically define which ingredients you can actually place and how many steps you're going to move, because you have one main marker and you have six actual pizza slices. And so you move the marker around, and wherever your marker ends, you put an ingredient in that zone. And at one point, if one of your pizza slices matches the exact description of one of the customers, you can score points by serving that pizza slice to that customer. But everybody can do the same thing. So there's a bit of a race aspect, because whoever actually serves the customer first will get more points than if they do it later. You're still going to get points. It's not a mean game in any way. But you obviously try to, outcook everybody else. That's the basic idea.
So now I want a pizza. So we have to.
it's honestly, we do recommend ordering some pizza when you play it, because we get hungry every time we do. So.
And don't get confused. Don't eat the tiles, the pizza tiles.
I wouldn't recommend it. We thought about making an edible version, but there were too many.
Special edition Pizza Hut version.
Can you imagine? Yes.
Okay. So, now we have another game like a circus style where you play artists in the ring that they have to perform an act. What kind of performance you can play as a player there?
Yeah, so circus is kind of about managing your own little circus. You have different kinds of artists, and you basically try to place them all in a certain order and actually let them do stuff. So they're going to perform acts one after the other. And there are also like assignment cards where you basically are going to try and collect certain skills and certain and that you're going to assign to actually those different artists. So it's a bit about managing what you see and also seeing what the other players are doing, because everybody also, same here, kind of manages their own little circus. And through the cards that you play in the game, you're going to try and score as many points as you can by playing them at the right time and at the right moment. You have to try and collect certain artists as well, because some of the special cards that you get do require you to get specific artists, like from a specific genre or from a specific gender even. And so you have to try and assign all that. And then there is a main, let's say, strip where the artists also can be purchased, but that's also a common pool for every player. So you try to manage that as well. And then there is a central game board where also at the end of a turn, you can try and unlock certain special abilities. So you can kind of boost your own little mechanic and make sure that you have your little engine going so that you can try and outbeat the others. But it's plays really smoothly. It seems a bit daunting at first because there's a lot of cards and but it's a very clever little mechanic that works quite well. And it's probably, I think, one of the most beautiful games we've ever made.
Okay, so yeah, let us see. Still a family game, 2 to 4 players. And this brings us to the last game. It's called Bugs. Yes. A quick card game. I think you try to lure the bugs with, I don't know, cheese, something they want. So what is the game? What's the fun in the game here?
Yeah. So Bugs is probably the most, I want to say, party-like game that we have. It's really fun. It's really zany. It's very quick. It's very chaotic. I mean, with a theme like Bugs, obviously, what would you expect? Yeah. But the idea is that, we loved the idea of the theme when it got pitched to us. But yeah, you try and literally lure bugs with like rotten meat or like a mangy cat, for the lice. So the bugs, basically, you try to collect as many as you can. And you're going to try and lure them. And so every turn, one of the lure cards is shown and you can see which type of food is going to attract which type of bug. But the big twist of the game is that, first of all, there is a blind bidding. So everybody can basically bid on one or the other because there's always two options. But then players have a set of action cards as well that they play, and there's 9 different ones, and they all have really strong effects on the game. And so whenever every player has to choose one as well, and they have to go through their entire deck throughout the game. So you can kind of, like, if you pay close attention, you can kind of try and remember who still has what card in their hand, because everybody has the same powers at the beginning. And you basically are going to change a lot of things. It could be, for instance, that the bug switch size, or that certain people suddenly cannot use their special power card. Others are going to freeze the bugs, so none of them will get distributed. There's a lot of stuff going on in this game. And it's very quick. Like, it's fun and easy to play. And it's a game, honestly, that we've played today, because it's perfect, like, to open a game night or close one. It's a lot of fun.
Sounds really fun. And I'm imagining right now a deluxe version of this game where you have a big jar full of bugs and roaches. And
we could do that, although I'm not sure people would be tempted to get that one.
I think so either. So, Rafael, thanks for your time that we chat a lot about the new games that are coming. I'm really looking forward to see more information about the games and see the games played on the table. And I wish you and your company a good time. Be healthy. And I hope we will see us in the near future in person.
Hope so too. Yeah, I think we really miss everyone as well. We hope that we can go to conventions somewhere later this year, but we'll see. We'll stay safe in the meantime.
Oh, okay, see ya.
Of course, have a great day.
Und für euch alle, die zugeschaut haben, euch natürlich auch eine gute Zeit. Ich hoffe, ihr habt ja wichtige Informationen hier mitnehmen können über die einzelnen Spiele. Ich bin schon sehr gespannt, weitere Informationen und natürlich die Spiele dann auch mal auf dem Tisch zu sehen. Also ich denke, eine große Bandbreite dabei, gerade mit der, sage ich mal, neuen Marke Amusa, auch Familien-Kinderspiel-Titel mit dabei. Also schaut mal, was bei Gamebrewer demnächst dann noch so passiert. Ich bin der Alex und bedanke mich. Ciao!